Let's pray. Every head bowed and every heart open to God. Father God, we come to you and we thank you. Today we praise you. We worship you. We are so grateful, Father God, because you give us the privilege. You allow us the great honor of just coming to your throne room and bowing before you. Lord, you've poured out your love in Jesus Christ. And then you poured out your love into our hearts through your Holy Spirit. And so we thank you, Lord. And we praise you for that great gift that you've given us. Father, there are so many in this place today who have needs. There are so many in this place today who are going through. Father, if we're honest, every one of us is going through. But Lord, what we've got to learn to do, and you help us with this, is, Father, learn not to look at the problem that's sitting right there in front of us, but we've got to learn to look past it. Fix our eyes on Jesus, the author, the finisher, the perfecter of our faith, and look at the finish line, not look at the starting line, and not look at everything that stands in our way that's trying to keep us from getting to you. Because, Father God, you know how to finish the race, and you've put that inside us. So, Father, I pray today. My prayer is that everyone in this place, that we learn how to not only stand firm on the rock of Jesus, we learn how to take the Word of God, and we learn how to use that Word, Father. We learn how to use that Word like it is a tool or like it is a weapon. And we will put on the full armor of God, and we will stand firm. And when we've done everything to stand, we will continue to stand firm, because we cannot be moved by an evil enemy, not when you are on our side and we are dressed in the weapons that you give us to overcome. So, Father God, we're a church, and we stand together today. We stand believing that you are the only true God, the all-powerful God, the almighty God, who hears our prayers, who invites us in to pray those prayers, and then you answer those prayers, Father, because you are a faithful God. Father, we thank you as we stand amazed in your presence. We thank you for everything that you've equipped us with. And God's people said, amen. Amen. I'm going to jump right on in. I think we should have preached today on Noah and the flood. From the way it sounds out there and for the way things have been going, I am extremely excited about what we're doing today. Children, you are dismissed. I don't want to forget that. Hey, guys, give me a little less on me, or bring up the house lights just a little bit. I like to see everybody's pretty face. There we go. There we go. That's great. Thank you. We're going to do something a little different today. We are going to tag team preach today. There are going to be three of us preaching. We are not the Three Stooges. We may act like it sometimes, but I'm not sure which one. I guess I'm Curly. One of the favorite lines of anybody I've ever heard is from Curly. So if at first you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed. So we're going to just try to succeed in bringing this message to you guys today. Praise the Lord. I am excited about what we're doing. Those of you who took part in the incredible season of prayer and the week-long prayer that we had. Would you raise your hands if you took part in that? Give me just a little more lights out there, guys. I want to see them. That's great. I'm believing still. I'm still believing that those prayers that we prayed and that time that we invested in doing what we were doing, that is a foundation that we are setting for this church. Amen? It's a foundation that we are laying. Now, we may not see it happening and changing the church on the outside yet, but you start with those types of weeks of prayer and that dedication to God and that dedication to prayer. You start in doing that, and where you first start to see it, it's like planting a seed. And you place that seed in here, and just like a seed that goes in the ground, it first has to die. And we have to die to ourselves as we prayed and we spent that time with God, so that that seed can then germinate and begin to grow. And we grow from the inside out. And that's the way God does everything. And friends, that was just the beginning. And as we start a new year at Greenview Christian Church, We need to start it once again with prayer, laying that foundation and taking what we have already placed inside us and helping that to grow and become stronger and take it to a new level, because we will not see the effect of that prayer on the outside in the seats and in the community until we first continue to let it grow up inside of us and overflow into the community, into the lives of people that we come in contact with. Amen? What we're going to talk about today is one of the most, it's one of the most well-known pieces of scripture in all the Bible. Everyone's heard it. We all know it. Psalm 23. It's been preached at funerals. It's been preached all, well, it's been preached all over at all times. It's really a prayer. So what I want to do is get my 10 minutes starting now. I want to introduce you to David, because David was one of the key figures in Scripture. And what when he wrote Psalm 23, he had insight that we want to share with you today, because we're going to look at 8 names of God that are found in Psalm 23. Now, they're not written there necessarily, but because of the way the Jewish mind and the Jewish culture thinks, there are 8 inferences to God. And different names would instantly come up to the Jewish mind. And that's what we want to look at today. David was an incredible man. One of the key men in the Old Testament. His life was an open book. Amen? I mean, we know more about that man than we probably know about our own relatives. Because God showed him to us. And we see all his flaws. We see all his greatness. We see everything about him, and God did not hide that, because he wanted us to see that even in our failures, he still loves us. And if we learn how to be a people that will repent, he will still use us to do mighty, incredible things in the kingdom of God. That excites me. Amen. Does it excite you? Come on, people, wake up today. Because we are now the ones that will affect the change. God's not going to do it. He's going to use us to do it. Amen? Amen. Man, he showed us everything. We saw his high points. We saw him go out and fight the giant as a 17-year-old boy. We saw him get anointed as a child by Samuel, the great prophet, the great judge, who came to his home and overlooked all the other 7 brothers and picked that young boy because he saw something special in him. More than just the outside appearance. But we saw Bathsheba. We saw the sin. He was many things. He was a shepherd. He was a king. He was a songwriter. He was a liar. He was a murderer. He was an adulterer. But folks, there's one thing in Scripture that impresses me so much. Above all else, the most important thing we see in Scripture concerning David, he's the only person in all the Bible that it is said of him, he was a man after God's own heart. Wow. That's impressive. That's impressive. In Psalm 23, there are 8 covenant names of God. Again, they don't appear. We miss so much in the English language, folks, when we read Scripture. And I'm just learning this now. As long as I've been saved and as long as I've been studying the Word of God, it's amazing what we can find when we go into the original language and start digging through that thing and start studying that. We've done it in the Greek for a long time in the New Testament. But when we uncover these things and look at these things, we see that David is, in the English language, we just miss it. He's using 8 covenant names of God as he is meditating in this song on the role that God is trying to play in our lives. Will we let him? Will we let him be God in our lives? Let me give you those 8. I'm not going to define them. Because we're going to do that together. Mike Walton will come up next, and then Jeff's going to close things out. Jehovah Roha. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Sitkanu, Jehovah Shema, Jehovah Nisi, and Jehovah Imkadesh. Now, those are pronounced and spelled differently by a lot of people, because when you're taking it out of Hebrew, you'll see various spellings and even pronunciations. But those eight names, covenant names of God, are all found in six verses, little verses of Scripture in Psalm 23. Let's go. I'm going to take the first couple. Got your Bible, turn to Psalm 23 if you're not there already. People, bring your Bible to church, okay? I'm telling you. Amen is right, brother. Because this is, look, a carpenter won't go out and start building a home without his hammer. A soldier is not going to go out to the battlefield without his gun. And when we, wherever, listen, we live in a world, I'm off the script, Jeff. We live in a world with the technology today, we can have the Bible with us wherever we go, 24 hours a day, all the time. I got it on my watch now. Okay? Get in the Word and stand on that Word and take it with you, because we must use it like a weapon, like a tool, when we go out and fight against Satan. Amen? All right. Verse 1. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. What he's saying, the word shepherd, he's using it's the imagery of a word, a covenant name for God, Jehovah Roha. What is a shepherd? A shepherd is a leader. A shepherd is someone who is not necessarily in control, but controls and shows you where to go and guides you and shows you how to get through things or get through life. David understood this twofold and passes this thought on to us now, using God as the great shepherd. David was a shepherd boy. He took care of sheep. I've been to Israel. I've been to Bethlehem. I've seen the fields there. He talks later on about green pastures. There are none. Green pastures are not green pastures. They're little tufts of grass that come up, and the shepherd must lead them to those so that those sheep can eat. David understood. He was the one that protected those sheep from the lion and from the bear. As a king in Scripture and throughout literature, a king is often referred to as a shepherd because he's leading and guiding his people. And this great king, this great shepherd boy, is now saying, whoa, 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 my God is Jehovah Roha, my shepherd. He leads me. I may lead a nation, but he leads me. He guides me. He's the one that takes me to the next place. He's the one that keeps me safe and shows me how to get where I need to go. I must follow the great shepherd, Jehovah Roha. He goes on, I shall not be in want. Folks, if you got a written Bible, take out a pen. If you don't write in your Bible, trust me, it's not a sin to write in your Bible. You need to be doing that. Here's what I got in mind. I shall not be in want for anything. Put that there, because that's the inference. I shall not be in want for anything. Jehovah Jireh. I preached on him not that long ago. The Lord, our provider. He is the God. What he's saying there about him is, I don't have to worry about any needs that I have in my life, because my God, Jehovah Jireh, he has seen my need before I saw my need, and he has then taken care of or provided a way to meet that need before I even knew that I had the need. That's a pretty awesome God. Jehovah Jireh. Whew. Verse 2. Time did I start, Lori? I forgot to set my timer. Oh, well. Verse 2. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside quiet waters. Green pastures, still waters. Jehovah Shalom. The God. I am the God of peace. Now, folks, there's peace is one of those words that we don't understand as American Christians. We think of peace when it comes to war, or we think of peace as everything being kind of calm, no problems, everything's just peaceful. It's way more than that. Way more than that. Peace, wholeness in your life. It's a covenant term. It's talking literally about salvation. When he says peace, he's talking about salvation. I got a study in my Bible that I started writing down. I just wrote the word salvation and started writing down everything that's included in salvation. It's the whole package, folks. It's everything God has done for us. It is all of it. And when he talks about peace, he's talking about taking care of us, our wholeness, our salvation. He's talking about our deliverance. He's talking, Lori, about health. When the angel said, peace on earth, goodwill to men, it wasn't that this little baby came and he's going to make everything just okay. It was that salvation has entered. God has done something incredible by bringing a baby and putting him in flesh, a God-man. Whew. Jehovah, Shalom. He's our wholeness, our everything. Yeah, he leads us by the quiet and still waters. Listen, there aren't any there. It's not a little brook or a little pool of, you know, a pond. They have floods because of the type of terrain and the dryness. And if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time, or at the right time, when those rains come, animals just are taken away. Because there's no runoff and there's no place for it. And he's saying he will show you the place where it's safe to take a drink. He will show you the place where it's you can find real food, where it grows, where God has provided. Whew. He is our shalom, our peace, our wholeness, our deliverer, our salvation. Verse 3, he restores my soul. He restores my soul. He is Jehovah Rapha, my healer, the one who heals. But it's more than that. David is saying, he restores my soul. Jehovah Rapha, you reconnect me spiritually. Jehovah Rapha. You renew my mind. You are my healer. Physically, spiritually, emotionally, mentally. That's who you are, God. Whew. He is Jehovah Roha. He is Jehovah Jireh. He is Jehovah Shalom. He is Jehovah Rapha. And he's so much more. Mike.
Okay, you can relax now, because I'm not a preacher. I'm not even a very good teacher. When Jeff asked me to do this today, I was surprised because this is talking about the names of God, and I can't remember names for 5 minutes. If I meet you, you tell me your name, I turn around, I come back, I've forgotten your name. But I do have one thing about me, I nickname people. How many of your kids have I nicknamed? Throughout church history, there's been so many kids come through here that I've given nicknames, and some of those kids have grown up now. In fact, I'd like to kind of see a show of hands if you know that I've nicknamed you and you remember what it is. All the kids are gone, and a lot of the kids have moved on. But for some reason, I can remember kids' names, the nicknames of kids, better than I can remember their kids. Why is that? That's kind of an odd thing, isn't it? That I can remember a nickname I give a kid when I can't remember his real name. I kind of get on a different plateau, a different place with your kids because of that name. These names show that I see them, I know them, and it creates a lasting relationship with them. Some of you that are older, you remember when you were kids, I gave you a nickname. You still have it today. Allie called you Bird Legs when you were a baby. For some reason, she was called Bird for years after that. You know, and there's other names. The Mulder family. These paths of righteousness is another name for God. And it's Jehovah Tzidkenu. It's the Lord is my righteousness. In him I have right standing before God. Jeremiah 23:5-6 says, this is before Jesus, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord, our righteous Savior. The word Tzidkenu is derived from Tzedek, which means righteousness. And this root is found in the name Melchizedek. He was the king of righteousness. Man alone, we alone, have no righteousness, especially before God's eyes. We can't do anything to attain righteousness other than believing in Christ. Romans 3:10 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Isaiah 64:6, all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. So we were all sinful. We are none of us righteous. How can we come before God, who cannot tolerate sin, unless we become righteous? Jesus himself is our Jehovah Tzidkenu. He's the righteous one. 1 Corinthians 1:30 says, it is because of him that you are in Christ, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Interesting about this statement, it says it's because of him that you are in Christ. God's leading us towards Christ. God leads us in those paths of righteousness towards the King of righteousness, who is Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. What we could not do, Jesus, the perfectly righteous one, did for us. Man tries to establish his own righteousness by acts, by works, by things we do and say, by how we appear, but it cannot be done. It doesn't matter how hard we work at it, we could not obtain righteousness on our own. Romans 10:3-4. Since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. Christ is the culmination of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Because of Christ, we can be righteous. It's because of Christ that when we stand before God, he does not see our sin. He sees us as righteous. What a wonderful name that God has used to describe himself. Verse 4 says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. How often have we heard that? This phraseology, walking through the valley of the shadow of death, is often used to convey a perilously threatening environment. Or it's thought of as going through times of trials and hardships and tribulations. But don't you think that the valley of the shadow of death is almost like us going through life alone. We're just going through life. We never know when death is going to strike. We always walk with death looming in one way, one form or another before us. Death could take us at any time. I'm reminded of the two young kids that were standing at a stop sign just the other day, and a car came the wrong way on a one-way street and hit them head on. They're both in the hospital. You know, they could have been killed. Who could have expected? Just different things in your lives brings you in contact with death. It's always there. The fear of death is one of our greatest fears in life. But because he has led us in the path of righteousness to Jesus, whose blood makes us righteous in God's eyes, then we have reason to fear no evil. For the Lord is with us. Which is the last part of that verse. For you are with me. And you are with me is the next name of God, Jehovah Shammah, which means the Lord is there. He is our ever-present God. Hebrews 13:5 says, for he himself has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. That's comforting words. You know that God's going to be there with us. He was in the garden with Adam and Eve. He was with Enoch and Noah, Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Jacob. This is interesting. You remember who Hagar was? Hagar was Sarah's maid, handservant, that she gave to Abraham to have a son by. Okay, he was there with Hagar in the desert after she had become pregnant with Ishmael, and Sarah sent her away. God appeared to her and told her to return to Abraham and Sarah. Hagar called God the God who sees even me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. He was now her God as well as Abraham. Don't you think growing up in the household of Abraham, she would have known of God? She would have heard Abraham talk of God, speak of God, but she was just a servant. She goes out in the desert. God appears to her. Now he's the God who sees even me. So she gave him a nickname. It was a personal relationship with God. He was there with the Israelites as a pillar of smoke and fire. He led them through the desert. He was there on Mount Sinai. He was there seated on the Ark of the Covenant in the tabernacle. He was there in the temple in Jerusalem. He is still in the temple of the new covenant, which is the Holy Spirit living in us. Isn't that comforting? Isn't that great to know? Jehovah Shammah only appears once in the Old Testament. Ezekiel is just describing a vision of the new Jerusalem that is in heaven. Ezekiel 48:35 says, and the name of the city from that time on will be the Lord is there, Jehovah Shammah, which means he's with us throughout our life. He's with us through everything, and he will be there in the end when we go to heaven. Another comforting thought. I'll go ahead and finish verse 4, although I don't have another name for this. I think there probably is one if you look deep enough. But the rest of verse 4 says, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And I'm sure there's names for that. They weren't on our list, and I didn't want to go too far. But the shepherd's club and crook were instruments of protection and direction and not instruments of afflictions and chastisements. So they were used to punish sheep. They were used to direct sheep. They were used to protect sheep. The rod is the word of God. Christ in his strength, power, and redemption that gives us direction and protection for our lives. And the staff is the promises and provisions of God to those who are in his household and under his care. What a comfort that is to those who believe. Do you believe? Do you have a personal relationship with God? Can you say, I know God on a certain level? You need to.
It was bright and early in the morning, and the Amalekites had been gathering around the Israelites, and there was going to be a war. There was going to be a battle that day. But the Lord had given Moses word that they were supposed to handle this battle a little different way than they had any other time before. You see, Moses had talked to Joshua beforehand. He said, I want you to go down and be prepared to fight the battle as we start this day. And Moses found himself going up on the top of a hill to oversee into the valley where the battle was going to take place. And he took his staff and he raised that staff high above his head. And he held his staff up and watched the battle happen. And it says in Scripture, in Exodus chapter 17, that as long as Moses stood with the staff high above his head and both hands up like this, that the Israelites continued to win the battle. But as he would get tired, if he would drop his arms down below his head, then the Amalekites, then they would start to win the battle. So what they started to do is Moses held his hands up as high as he possibly could, and it says when he got tired, they rolled the rock over to where he was standing so that he could sit down because his legs were tired. And then Aaron on one side and Hur on the other upheld his arms so that that staff and his hands would not go below his head. And it says that day that the Israelites took victory upon the Amalekites. And they won that battle. As the battle was over, the Lord approached Moses once again. And it says in Exodus chapter 17, verse 14, it says, the Lord said to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered. And make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the name of Amalek from under heaven. Moses built an altar and called it, the Lord is my banner. He said, because hands were lifted up against the throne of the Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. You see, that day, as Moses held his hands up, it was a teaching point, not only for all of Israel, but specifically for Joshua, because Joshua was going to take the Israelites into the promised land, and he was going to take on all these different people groups who had held their hands up against the Lord Most High. And he wanted Joshua to remember that God is his banner, held high. In Psalm 23, starting in verse 5, it says that you prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. Many times in Scripture, as they fought wars or they were trying to protect a group, the place not to be was in the woods. The place not to be was in the valley, but the place to be was up on high on a rock. As a shepherd guarding over your sheep, the place was not necessarily in times of danger to be down in the valley, but to bring the sheep up into a place that was high and flat. And it was a place of protection. And because you were up so high, it was held high as a banner. You see, David in Psalm chapter 18 speaks of these very things. And he says this. Sorry, I got a new Bible and everything's out of place. And nothing's underlined. So, Psalm chapter 18, and I think I've got it written down here, verses 16 through 19, it says, he reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of the deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. And then again, over a little bit farther in chapter 18, starting in verse 31, it says, who is God besides the Lord? And who is the rock except our God?
It is God who arms me with strength and keeps my way secure. He makes me my feet like the feet of a deer, because he causes me to stand on the heights. See, it's up on that spacious plateau. Have you ever heard of Table Rock before? Okay, down around Table Rock Lake. It's a place with high bluffs, okay, as it overlooks the lake and other places in the countryside. There's large, flat places that are safe, a safe haven for us to gather. And so when David is talking about God preparing for him a table in the presence of his enemies, this is Jehovah Nissi, okay? The Lord is my banner. He invites us to sit down and to dine with him at a high place. And we find comfort there. Just as Moses found comfort up on top of a rock with his friends and companions holding his arms up towards the sky because they knew that God would deliver. In verse 6, or is continuing on in verse 5, sorry, it says, "You anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows." I don't know if you guys have noticed that as Psalm 23 has been read by the three of us, that it starts out in the third person and it says, "The Lord, he, and then it switches and it says, "You." You see, this prayer is a very personal thing. And David is addressing God as "You." You are my God. You're not just a God. You're not the God of somebody else. You're my God. In Psalm chapter 133, it's a beautiful psalm that talks about the anointing that comes from the Lord and when we gather together in unity as believers. And I want to read that for you this morning because it is extremely powerful, but extremely intimate. It says, "How good and pleasant is it when God's people live together in unity. It's like precious oil poured on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe, as if it's the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion. For there the Lord bestows his blessings, even life forevermore." So you get this picture that when we gather together in unity, that the blessing of the Lord is there and his anointing flows down upon all of us. And it flows down in so much that it's just dripping off of us. And that is God's presence. This is called Jehovah Makedesh, or Makedesh Kim. In Exodus chapter 31, Moses is getting instructions from the Lord, and he's talking about setting up the Sabbath day to make it holy. And he says, "Because I am the Lord who makes you holy. I'm the Lord who sanctifies you." And when we come to God, and I know in today's day and age we preach a gospel of grace and love. But the gospel is so much more than that as well. It's a gospel that when we accept it, we are changed and we're made holy. And we can only be made holy by the one who is holy. In Leviticus chapter 10, God had to take care of some ugly business because Aaron's sons, who had been appointed as priests, had handled some things not so adequately, and God struck them down. And in the midst of that, God says this, "Among those who approach me, I will be proved holy. In the sight of all people, I will be honored." You see, God is a holy God. He's not only a righteous God, like Mike was talking about, he's a holy God. And the way that we approach God, we have to be very careful because he's not one who can be approached haphazardly. When it's time to approach God, we approach him in the utmost holiness. But we ourselves can't be holy by ourselves. He's the one who has to make us holy. That's why it is so comforting in John chapter 17. It says this, as Jesus is praying before the Father. And these are some awesome comforting words. John 17, verses 15 and following, it says, "My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth." That's how we're sanctified, is by letting the word penetrate inside of us. "As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For I sanctify myself, I make myself holy, that they too may be truly sanctified," or made holy. You see, it's God who sanctifies us. That word, Jehovah Makedesh, okay, or Makedesh Kim, and the root Hebrew word is Kadash. Kadash means to sanctify, to consecrate, to make holy. We serve a holy God. In verse 6, and I appreciate Terry and Mike setting up this as we've gone along. And honestly, folks, outside of one piece of paper, we haven't talked about this. But I am simply amazed every single time how the Holy Spirit orchestrates things together for the good of his people. Verse 6 says, "Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The golden calf had been built, and Israel had been clamoring down in the valley when Moses was up on the mountain to receive the Ten Commandments. And when Moses heard this and God heard this, God was enraged. And he said, "I'm just going to take them out. I'm going to take every single one of them out. I don't want to deal with it anymore. I'm tired of the complaining. I'm tired of the arguing. I'm tired of all the back talking and the disobedience. I'm just going to take you with me, and that's it." And Moses pleads before the Lord, and he says, "Hey, no. He says, "God, these are your people that you call by your name. We can't do this unless you go with us." And it says there that the Lord relented, and he changed his mind. And then they started to set up something new. It was the tabernacle. And it was going to be a thing that the Lord could go with them no matter where they were. It's like that Shema that Mike was talking about, that the Lord is there. And Moses requested something of God, and he says, "You got to show me something. I need to see you. I need to be in your presence." And God says, "Okay, I can do this." And so in Exodus chapter 33, God gives him kind of a foretaste of what's going to happen. In verse 17, he says, "I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you and I know you by name." Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you. I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. But you cannot see me, see my face, because no one may see me and live." So this is what the Lord does. He passes right in front of Moses. And down in Exodus 34, starting in verse 5, it says, "The Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord, Yahweh, Jehovah. And he passed in front of Moses proclaiming, 'The Lord, Yahweh, Yahweh, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sins of the parents to the third and the fourth generation.'" You see, Moses had it figured out. He says, "Lord, unless you're with us, we can't go anywhere, because it's by your name that we are identified. We're identified as your people. And without you, we're aimless, we're powerless, we're helpless, just like sheep." And David understood this as he's writing the 23rd Psalm, because he says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the presence of the Lord all the days of my life. All the days. You see, as we approach this New Year's, it's important for us to note this, that we need to respond to the name and the character of God rather than react to our circumstances. And if we learn this as a church, it's going to be an amazing 2016. I'm going to say this again. We need to learn how to respond to the name and the character of God instead of reacting to our circumstances. I've got one last passage that I want to read for you, and it's found in Isaiah chapter 40. And we might have taken more time this morning, but I'm not going to apologize for that. And it wasn't Terry's fault, okay? I'll even say that publicly. Because we need to spend time with God. We need to hear His Word. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 11, talks about God as a shepherd. And it says this, He tends His flock like a shepherd, and He gathers the lambs in His arms, and He carries them close to His heart. He gently leads those who have young. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of His hand, or with the breadth of His hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who can fathom the Spirit of the Lord or instruct the Lord in His counsel? Whom did the Lord consult or enlighten him, and who taught Him the right way? Who was it that taught Him knowledge or showed Him the path of understanding? You see, we serve a great God. And we've just unfolded to you eight names of God. There's many more. But God's awesome. But He's also our shepherd. And He cares for us. And just like Isaiah says, He holds us close to His heart and cares for us as if we were a lamb. And those who have young ones, He helps us raise them and teach them and lead them. That's an amazing promise. Next week, we're going to open up the halls again. And it's going to be a prayer passage again. But as Terry kind of alluded to, it's going to be different this time. We had a lot of prayer stations last time, but it's going to be all about the name of God. And we want you guys to spend the week after next camping out in the presence, focusing on God and His character and His name rather than our circumstances. One thing that we noticed at the end of the week of the last prayer passage is that the heaviest traveled area was the prayer request section. And it's awesome to have requests laid before the Lord. But if you spend time with Him in His presence and you respond to His holiness and His righteousness and recognize Him as your provider, all these things will be added unto you. Seek Him first. And the other stuff second. So it's time for an invitation. If you want to respond to God, to His name, and to His character, then we invite you to do that this morning as the band plays. If you want to renew your relationship with Him, or be joined with Him in relationship for the very first time, we invite you to come and respond to His holiness and His righteousness for His name's sake. So seek and respond with us this morning. God bless you guys. Guess what? We've got two baptisms this morning, and Claude's back there with a couple of them right now. So please be seated. We're going to pray for the offering and take up what is due to God. And then we'll get into the baptisms. And I think Grace has some announcements for us as well. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, You are holy God, and I thank You and praise You for Your names.
the many names that you have. Lord, you are our shepherd, and we are the sheep of your pasture. Lord, guide us into this new year. Lead us for your name's sake. Lord, we desire to be in your presence all the days of our life. There's that sweet spot. There's that wonderful place that we can find comfort. Lord, I pray that as we take up the offering this morning, Lord, the money that is due to you, Lord, that you'll be honored by that this morning. Lord, that if there's somebody who has some seed that they need to sow and put in deep into the ground, Lord, by sowing finances for a particular reason, Lord, that you will bless that seed and that you'll allow it to grow for kingdom purposes and that you'll be honored by that. Lord, thank you so much for being our God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I'm Grace Malakovic, and here's what's happening at Greenview Christian Church. Bible Studies for Life is back in session tonight from 5 to 6. There is something for all ages. Midweek Connection will be omitted this Wednesday and resume Wednesday, January 6th. Elder and deacon nominations are due today. Extra forms are available in the Welcome Center, where you will also find a box for your nominations. We are in need of church van drivers. See Ben Kennedy for more information. Starting in January, the monthly church newsletter will come in the form of an email. If you have not turned in your email addresses, please do so ASAP. If you would prefer a paper copy, please let the office know. The paper copies will be placed on the information table in the Welcome Center for those who requested not to receive the newsletters electronically. Greenview Christian Church is preparing to embark on an amazing week of prayer, January 4th through the 8th. Look for more information to come. And for more information, be sure to read your bulletin. You can like our Facebook page and check out our website at greenviewchurch.org, where you can view sermons and keep up to date with the latest happenings. Thank you for worshiping with us today, and we have some baptisms.
Hey, give God some praise for more. In that 23rd Psalm, there's a great place that says, "Yea, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." You heard him say, we're all going to walk through that valley someday, but the blessing of that is in verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. Our shepherd's going to walk with us the whole way. And Scott comes here today. He's been coming here for quite a while. He came to me about 3 weeks ago and he said, "I want to be baptized." He felt convicted by the Word of God and the Holy Spirit. And today, Scott has come because this is the day the Lord's made his wife. Amen? All right. Okay. So if you would, if you put your hand here. And this is the profession of faith that we read in the Word. We know that this took place before every immersion. I'd like to ask you if you would do that for me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. I make him my Lord and the Savior of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Praise God. Many of you might know Ryan here. He's grew up here in this church, and he's moved away, but he gets to come home occasionally. And here a while back, Curtis had come, and him and his dad had been talking about baptism and giving his life to Jesus. And so this was a great time because His dad happened to be here during this season. He come home, and this is going to be a wonderful time for you to make your faith and your decision solid today, but also to make a great opportunity for you and your dad to do this together, where he can be a big part of this. I just want to tell you, as we've already went long, so it's okay, I can say this. I just want to tell you that this decision you're making today, every other choice you make the rest of your life needs to be based upon this. You need to come back to this with every choice, every decision, every question, and every answer. It needs to come back to the day that you gave your life to Jesus Christ, the where you died. I wish someone would have told me this was the day you die in Christ when I was a child. This is the day you die and you come to life. And I hope and pray that today that you take that in, okay? All right, if you would, come on. Put your hand right here. And if you would, just repeat after me this profession of faith that I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. I make him my Lord and the Savior of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Dad.
Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Okay. All right. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I want one for the scrapbook. Well, it's been good to be in God's house today, amen? We've had good worship, good word. God's been good, amen? People's lives, souls saved. I pray you have a great new year. I also pray that I don't read your name in the paper. I hope that if it's in there, that it's for a good reason, okay? We look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Remember, tonight, we're back out for Bible Studies for Life. Hope to see you. God bless you. Have a great day.